Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 25th April 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles is provided in the description box. For the benefit of mobile phone viewers, timestamping of the news articles is also provided in the comment section. Moving on to the first article, see the article appears on page number 13 in Chennai, Bengaluru, Thiruvananthapuram and Delhi editions of the newspaper. The article says that the central bank, which is the RBI, has divested its entire stake in NABARD and National Housing Bank. The information in the article will be helpful for your preliminary examination under economic and social development, and in mains it will be helpful in statutory and regulatory bodies in GS paper 2 and in Indian economy in GS paper 3. Before entering into the news, we shall know about National Housing Bank. See, prior to 1988, there was no availability of long-term finance to individual households, and this was a major hurdle in the progress of housing sector. Therefore, setting up a national level institution was recommended by the subgroup on housing finance for the 7th five-year plan. The period of consideration for the 7th five-year plan is 1985 to 1990. See, the setting up of National Housing Bank as an autonomous housing finance institution was recommended by the high-level group under the chairmanship of Dr. C. Rangarajan, then Deputy Governor of Reserve Bank of India. Thereby, National Housing Bank was set up in the year 1988 as a statutory authority by the statute National Housing Bank Act of 1987 as a principal agency to promote housing finance institutions both at local and regional levels and to provide financial and other support to such housing finance institutions. And the Reserve Bank of India contributed the entire paid up capital. Till recently, the RBI had 100% shareholding in the National Housing Bank. A committee on banking sector reforms was formed in 1998 under the chairmanship of Mr. Narasimham to initiate the second generation of financial sector reform. The committee submitted its report in April 1998. The report was also called as Narasimham Committee Second Report. It focused on structural changes to strengthen the banking system to make it more stable. One major recommendation of the committee is that the Reserve Bank, as a regulator of the monetary system, should not be the owner of a bank in view of the potential for possible conflict of interest. Hence, it would be necessary for the Reserve Bank of India to divest its stake in these nationalized banks and in the State Bank of India. Till February 2019, the capital of National Housing Bank is fully subscribed by RBI. Then, in accordance to the recommendation of the Narasimham Committee too, the RBI has now divested its entire stake held in National Housing Bank to the central government. Now, the 100% stake is held by the government of India. See, divestment is a process of a company selling its assets, often to improve its value and to obtain higher efficiency and also to achieve other objectives. It is opposite of investment. Here, RBI has sold its shareholding to the central government to avoid conflict of interest. As a result of this divestment, the financing role of National Housing Bank will get strengthened, and thus the possibility of increased funding support to housing finance companies is now more. Coming to NABARD, the bank was established by the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development Act of 1981 based on the recommendation in interim report of Mr. Sivaraman Committee, which was formed to review the arrangements for institutional credit for agriculture and rural development. Now, the RBI stake in NABARD was divested in two phases. See, before October 2010, RBI had 72.5% stake in NABARD, of which 71.5% stake was divested in October 2010, and the remaining stake was divested recently in the month of February 2019. Now, the practice prelims question will be discussed in the last part of this video. With this, let's move on to the analysis of our next news article. This article appears on page number 18 of all the editions. The information under this article is relevant in the preliminary examination under current events of national importance and general science, and is relevant in the mains examination in GS paper 3 under science and technology, developments and their applications and effects in everyday life. The Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology is a CSIR lab and a premier research organization in modern biology. It has found a novel way, meaning an unusual way of tackling antibiotic resistant bacterial strains. They have isolated an antimicrobial protein found in the milk of echidna. Antimicrobial proteins play key roles in innate immunity. As the name suggests, they are anti or they work against the microbes. Antimicrobial peptides or proteins are a diverse class of naturally occurring molecules that are produced as a first line of defense by all multicellular organisms. These proteins can have broad activity to directly kill bacteria, yeasts, fungi, viruses, and even cancer cells. In echidnas, the young hatch from eggs at a very early stage of development, and they depend completely on mother's milk. But the mammary glands of the echidnas are devoid of nipples, forcing the young ones to get milk by licking the mother's body surface, which potentially makes them vulnerable to microorganisms. Mammary glands are organs present in female mammals which produce milk for the sustenance of the young. The scientists found that the antimicrobial protein identified in the milk of echidna has been found to keep the young ones safer from infections. The protein found in the milk promises to serve as an alternative to antibiotics used on livestock, because as we have already seen, the milk of echidna with the protein can puncture the cell membranes of multiple bacterial species, thus destroying the source of infection. Scientists from the research team said that there are ways to produce the protein in large quantities using E. coli, which is an easy-to-use system for life scientists and the industry. It can then be used to fight infections. Here, the E. coli mentioned is a short form of Escherichia coli, and is a bacterium that is commonly found in the gut of humans and warm-blooded animals. Most strains of E. coli are harmless, but some can cause serious food poisoning. The scientists pointed out that there is a rise of superbugs due to the indiscriminate use of antibiotics by the animal husbandry industry to raise livestock. These superbugs can cause mastitis, an infection of the mammary gland in dairy animals. Here, the antimicrobial protein could be a solution. The scientists concluded that these studies give a novel or unusual approach to fight infectious diseases by taking clues from nature. Thus, they are the best way forward in the emerging scenario of increased infectious disease burden and resistance to current treatment methods. In the context of this article, let us see some important facts about echidna. Echidnas are the egg-laying mammals. They are also called as spiny anteaters. There are two egg-laying mammals in the world. One is echidna and the other is platypus. Because we know mammals give birth to young ones and does not lay eggs. And note that echidnas are different from porcupines, though they both have spines and may look similar. These echidnas are found only in Australia and New Guinea. There are two species of echidna. One is the long-beaked echidna and is listed as, the long-beaked echidna is listed as critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. The other one is the short-beaked echidna and it is listed as least concern in the IUCN Red List. With this, we come to the end of this news article. The displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session, a previously appeared question in the UPSC preliminary examination in the year 2015 has been shown here for the benefit of students. The next news article is Attapady student police cadets on cloud 9. Cloud 9 is an idiom which means extremely happy or feeling satisfactory. This news article has appeared in page number 4 of the Thiruvananthapuram edition only and not in any other editions of the Hindu newspaper. The information given in this article come under current events of national and international importance and in social geography of India. This news article mentions about the successful efforts of the Students Cadet Club of Attapady on creating awareness on the need to vote among the tribal population of the region. In this news article, three tribal group names have been mentioned, who are Irulas, Kurumbas and Muduvas. Let us now compare these people belonging to these tribes from the table given here. Irulas are notified scheduled tribal group in the states of Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So is the Kurumba tribal group. See, the Kurumba tribal groups are called as Kurubas in the state of Karnataka. Muduva tribal groups are notified scheduled tribal groups in the states of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Next, we shall be seeing whether these tribal groups have been designated by the Ministry of Home Affairs as particularly vulnerable tribal groups. See, Irulas have been designated under PVTG category only in the state of Tamil Nadu, although they reside in the other two states such as Kerala and Karnataka. Kurumbas are designated under this PVTG category in the states of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Muduvas are not designated under this PVTG category in any of the states. Next, coming to the occupation, Irula's main occupation includes snake catching, rat catching and also honey collection. Kurumba's main occupation includes collection of forest produce. The Muduvas are slightly advanced comparing to other two involving in agricultural activities. They largely produce crops like ragi, cardamom, etc. Irula tribal populations largely reside in the western region of Tamil Nadu, like in the such as the districts of Nilgiris, Coimbatore, etc. and in the state of Kerala in the districts of Palakkad and Wayanad. In Karnataka, they live close to Western Ghats in areas surrounding Bandipur National Park. Kurumba tribal populations largely reside in Nilgiris district of Tamil Nadu, Wayanad district of Kerala and in Coorg district of Karnataka, where they are referred as I already told, Kurubas. Finally, Muduva tribal populations largely reside in Idukki district of Kerala and in Valparai region of Tamil Nadu. See, the displayed question will be discussed in the final session. Let us now move on to the next news article. This news article appears on page number 18 in all the four editions. See, the information given in the article come under current events of national and international importance and in general science. This news article describes about China's announcement to send a manned mission to moon and to build a research station there within 10 years. The south pole of the moon has been chosen to build the research station. It is to be noted that China has recently become the first nation in the world to land a rover on the far side of the moon to re-establish its aim to achieve super space power status. Here note that China's National Space Administration carries out all the space related activities similar to India's ISRO. Let us see some of the future plans of China related to space activities. China plans to launch a Mars probe by 2020. China also plans for the maiden flight of March 5 Capital B rocket in the year 2020. This rocket would carry the core parts of a planned space station. This planned space station is named as Tiangong, meaning heavenly palace in Chinese language. China also plans to launch its fourth lunar probe named Chang'e 5. Let us know about Chang'e 5 in brief now. See, it is a robotic lunar exploration or moon exploration mission of China. This mission consists of a lander and a vehicle to bring back sample. The main aim of this mission is to return to Earth with at least 2 kilograms of lunar soil and rock samples from moon. This mission is planned to be launched by the end of this year, that is 2019. There is also another news highlighted along with this news article, which is NASA probe picks up first detected Mars quake. It tells that NASA probe has picked up the first detected Mars quake. This probe has been sent as a part of InSight lander mission. Let's see a very brief comparison here in this table between Earth and Mars in terms of or with respect to seismology. Earth is seismically very active. It has been presumed till now that Mars is not seismically active, but the recording from InSight lander's probe give a proof that Mars is seismically active, but comparably very less than Earth. Earth is seismically active because of the presence of tectonic plates, whereas it is absent in the case of Mars. Hence, Mars seismic activities are very few. In the context of this news article, let us try to know in brief about NASA's InSight mission. InSight mission is the robotic lander mission of Mars. The objectives of this mission are that it should place a seismometer on the surface of Mars in order to detect seismic activities, if any, in Mars. The news article is related to this. Next, this mission aims to provide accurate three-dimensional models of the planet's interior. And finally, this mission would measure the internal heat flow occurring in Mars, which would help in studying the geological evolution of Mars. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last part of the video. Let us now move on to the analysis of next news article. The next news article of the day is the editorial titled Beyond the Free Trade Idealism, which has appeared in page number 8 in all the editions. Now, the various aspects of this news article could come under government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation in GS2 and in Indian economy and issues related to employment in GS paper 3. The main content featured in this article is that beyond free trade policies, the new government, which is to be formed after elections, should develop an ambitious employment and income policy. The author has discussed about few concepts of free trade, then his views about job growth, and finally his suggestions to improve the employment and income opportunities in India. The article is largely concept-based without statistics. The first part of the editorial discusses about few concepts of free trade. The author has quoted macroeconomic case of free trade by Danny Rodrick, a Turkish economist. The macroeconomic case of free trade is that if each person would do only what he or she does better than everyone else and the output would be traded with each other, then everyone's welfare would increase. Further, there will not be any inefficiency in the output. It would result in large share of the global economy by each country. On this basis, the author shares Danny Rodrick's views, telling that India must have focused on imports after independence. Easy imports by any country means it would increase the consumer welfare. Here, the author means to tell that the consumers of the importing country will have more accessibility to foreign goods that are best produced by the respective countries. The author has then quoted Milton Friedman, an American economist. Milton Friedman has told that in international trade, the exports help the companies in terms of profits and the imports help the citizens in terms of availability. On this, the author shares that the resistance of free trade does not come from consumers of the importing countries, that is not from the import side. But the resistance comes from the export side, nothing but the companies that are exporting. Companies from both the underdeveloped and the developing world resist free trade due to following reasons. The companies from the less developed nations resist free trade because they are not competitive enough due to the poor infrastructure or due to insufficient capabilities on their side. This would lead to their competitors from other countries overtaking them, leading to their loss. The companies from the developed world also resist free trade on the presumption that the producers from the developing countries overtaking them. In the next part of the editorial, the author has discussed about job growth. The author tells that if the citizens should benefit from easy imports because of free trade, they require sufficient incomes. Sufficient incomes can be generated only when there are employment opportunities. The author tells that it is the responsibility of the governments to take care of citizens' welfare. This can be achieved only through a good industrial policy in order to compete with the developed nations. The author then explains about the history of free trade policy and how it has affected the job growth in India. He tells that with the introduction of free trade policy, the Soviet concept of industrial policy has become a taboo. In 1990, India liberalized imports and it largely benefited the Indian consumer. Introduction of free trade plus the lack of good industrial policy weakened India's manufacturing sector. Next is India's GDP growth versus employment. The author notes that the impressive growth rates of GDP in India did not actually generate huge employment opportunities in India. India is at one of the lowest positions globally if the number of jobs created per unit of GDP growth is taken into account. In the final part of the editorial, the author has shared his viewpoints about Indian economy, especially from employment and income angle, and has suggested some measures to improve the same. The author asks the Indian economists to find way for a realistic economic growth in the economy. This can be achieved by producing more income generating opportunities, tells the author. The author finds all the universal basic income schemes announced by major political parties would not be economically sustainable in the long run. Hence, the author insists that the employment and income policy must be the highest priority of the newly formed government. The author then shares about the strengths of India, like India has a large number of trainable youth, and the present digital technologies available in India can generate income opportunities to tap in the form of imports and exports. Finally, the author has listed three suggestions. The author notes the governance of World Trade Organization must undergo changes, and that World Trade Organization must promote poor countries' welfare rather supporting and promoting the rich countries in the name of free trade policy. So here the author comes to tell that the World Trade Organization must favor an equitable growth of all countries instead of supporting only the rich countries. Secondly, the author suggests that the Indian economists should return to the fundamentals of economic growth. Instead of focusing on the calculation of the universal basic income that will end up being unsustainable in the long run. The author is critical of the Indian economists here. Finally, the author suggests that the new government must formulate a robust income and employment policy supported by an imaginative, meaning a visionary or a creative industrial policy. This employment and income policy must guide the trade policy of India. Thus, the essence of this article is that keeping aside the free trade policy of the government because it does not promote manufacturing sector, only a robust income and employment policy will be a concrete and a sustainable measure of economic growth. With this, we come to the end of this news article. Let's move on to the next article. Now, this article appears on page number 9 in all the 4 editions, and the Belt and Road Initiative has also been advertised in page 3 of Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper. The article come under current events of national and international importance in prelims and mains under international relations, India and its neighborhood in GS paper 2. Before entering into the article, a few points about this Belt and Road Initiative. See, it is initiated by China. It's a combination of Silk Road Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Road. Silk Road Economic Belt is proposed to link China to Central Asia, South Asia and onward to Europe. The new Maritime Silk Road proposed to connect Chinese coastline with Southeast Asia, Gulf countries and North Africa and on to Europe. The article is in news because India has planned to boycott the BRI forum, which is to begin from April 25 in China, and this meeting is to be attended by around 37 countries including Pakistan. The United States of America has also publicly announced boycotting the meeting by calling it a vanity project. The author in this article gives 5 reasons why India should have sent an observer to the Belt and Road Initiative Forum meeting in China. See, in the 21st century, Asia has become the center of the world. To substantiate this, the author highlights the middle class consumption growth estimates. There is a rise in consumption growth and it is estimated to become $30 trillion by 2030, of which at that time just 3% of which will be from the Western countries. The majority of the remaining 97% contribution will be from the Asia. Also, to project that India will have better prospects in 2050, the author states by 2050, while the working age population will decrease in China by 20 crore, in India, it is going to increase by 20 crores. Countries in the Asian continent are not preferring or subscribing to a China-led Asia. Thus, the author here emphasizes that Asia is not only about China, where he implicitly means the future and some present better prospects are favoring India. And this is one reason why India should have sent an observer to BRI Forum. Secondly, the global reach of Belt and Road Initiative signals the political end of the old economic order shaped by G7 countries. G7 means 7 countries that are United States of America, United Kingdom, France, Germany, Japan, Italy and Canada. See, to substantiate that, the old economic order is nearing its end and new economic order has subscribers who once shaped the old order The author has given two examples. One, Italy, a member of G7, has joined BRI. That shows the importance of BRI as part of new economic order. And UK, which is also a member of G7, has joined the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank in 2015. Thus, the author states that the new order with such a global reach should not exclude India, and therefore India should have sent an observer to BRI Forum. Already, Asia has gained global attention in having infrastructure as the key driver of economic growth. Now, this was done by Asian Development Bank. Similar fortunes can also be seen with Belt and Road Initiative, says the author. See, BRI is an infrastructure-based development project which is inclusive of both physical and digital infrastructure for various sectors that catalysts the growth in participating countries of this initiative. Despite excess debt, political corruption and policy shifts after a change in governments in some participating countries, the popularity of BRI is still remaining the same. Therefore, sending an observer to an initiative from Asia of such significance and such global reach is important for India. Fourthly, the author states that BRI has been evolving from the character of lack of transparency and non-beneficial nature for participating countries to standards of multilateralism. Standards of multilateralism necessitates benefits for all participants. This is done by having linkages with UN Sustainable Development Goals and also by having close collaboration with International Monetary Fund and other multilateral institutions. We should note that the IMF describes BRI as an important contribution to the global economy. Now that there is a possibility of addressing national concerns, India should not stay away from this Asian-led global new order, and therefore it should have sent an observer to the forum meeting. The fifth reason, the author says, while China can use Belt and Road Initiative for its strategic objectives such as building bases and projecting as naval power by making the participant countries to accept certain rules similar to Marshall Plan of United States to build or to rebuild Europe after World War II. However, the Chinese projection here will not have a significant impact, says the author. BRI's commercial advantage has projected the image of China. For India to do so, will have to devise new standards. Devising new standards and joining the initiative may strategically advantage India. Thus, the author highlights five reasons for alongside the importance of BRI and participation of India in it at some level, at least as an observer at the present time. Additionally, the author states that the cooperative vision as stated by Indian Prime Minister should be adopted by the two Asian giants, China and India, rather than adopting or succumbing to the Asia containment view of the United States. See, for the containment view of United States strategy to fall, the two giants need each other, and BRI is a way to do that. There is also a strategic complexity for India associated with BRI initiative as it cuts through Gilgit-Baltistan and Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Now, according to author, this can be responded by three diplomatic initiatives. One, using appropriate text that states a British-led coup by the Gilgit scouts led to Pakistani occupation of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and using this text to recognize India's sovereignty over the disputed territory. Two, by giving South Asian character to the two BRI corridors on India's western and eastern flanks and by linking them with Asian regions or ASEAN regions. And finally, India has to multilateralize this BRI initiative with a set of rules. With this, we can respond to the strategic complexity associated with BRI initiative. The displayed mains question will be discussed in the last part of the video. With this, we have come to the end of analyzing the articles, and now let us move on to practice cum revision session, the final session of the video. We have now come to the final session of our analysis. Let's see the first practice question. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements given above are correct. The first statement, Reserve Bank of India has 100% shareholding in the National Housing Bank. See, this statement is wrong. As we have seen, after the recent divestment of entire share of National Housing Bank, now the ownership of this NHB is with Government of India and not with Reserve Bank of India. The second statement, the Committee on Banking Sector Reforms has in its report recommended RBI to divest their stake in nationalized banks. See, this statement is correct, as the Committee on Banking Sector Reforms under the chairmanship of Mr. Narasimham has recommended RBI to divest their stake in nationalized banks in view of the potential for the possible conflict of interest. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, the second question is with reference to the mammal echidna. They have given three statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. Keep in mind that we have to look for the correct statement. The first statement says it is an egg-laying mammal which is found only in India. Now, we know that yes, echidna is an egg-laying mammal, but it is found only in Australia and New Guinea. So, the first statement is wrong. The second statement, the short-beaked echidna is listed as critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. We know that it is only the long-beaked echidna listed as critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. The short-beaked echidna is listed as least concern. So, therefore, the second statement is wrong. And the third statement, scientists have found that the proteins present in echidna's milk have a characteristic of antimicrobial protein. Now, this statement is correct. Correct option for this question is option C, 3 only. Now, the third question, they have given people belonging to Karbi, Chenjus and Irula tribe on one side, and they are asking their corresponding states where they live. Now, the first pair, Karbi. Now, we know that people belonging to Karbi tribe are in the state of Assam. And the second pair, people belonging to the Chenju tribe are in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Now, the facts about these two tribal population were discussed in our current affairs analysis on 20th April and 18th April respectively. So, you may refer them for clarity related to these two population belonging to these two tribes. And third pair, they have given Irula, and they are asking which state. They have given the status Kerala. See, Irulas are the people belonging to Irula tribe are the notified scheduled tribes in the state of Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. The question has asked for choosing the correct pairs. So here the correct answer is option C, 3 only, because only the third pair is correctly matched. Now, in question 4, they have asked us to identify the correct pairs matched. They have given astronomical missions on one side and the corresponding countries on the other side. Now, based on today's discussion, the first pair, Chang'e 5. So, we know that this mission is a mission of China. It is incorrectly matched as Japan. And Tiangong is a mission of China and it is correctly matched. And Gaganyaan is a manned spacecraft mission and it is matched correctly. And InSight is a robotic lander mission for exploring Mars by United States of America. So we find that first pair is matched incorrectly. So if we know that the first pair is matched incorrectly, we know that it should not, any options here should not have one as an answer. So we can eliminate A, B and D. So we get the correct option as option C. So even by elimination technique, we can get the correct answer. For the question is option C, 2, 3 and 4 only. We have discussed in detail about Gaganyaan in yesterday's session. Now, coming to the mains question, this question could be asked in GS paper 2. The question reads as, beyond free trade idealism, an ambitious employment and income policy must be the top priority of the governments. Discuss. See, in the first part, you may discuss about what is free trade and about its pros and cons on Indian economic growth as discussed in our editorial analysis. And for the second part, you may discuss how employment and income are crucial for a country's growth and include the suggestions given by the author, that is how employment and income policy would help develop India's economy. You can also include your views on this topic along with some statistics to enrich the answer. Now, the second mains question, critically evaluate the growing importance of China's Belt and Road Initiative in the world economy and its impact on India for its non-participation under GS2. Here, you may highlight the global reach the BRI initiative has by highlighting that Italy has joined this BRI initiative and IMF has stated this initiative's importance for global economy and which we could see by participation of more than 30 countries. For the second part, you may add how India may lose the link with the physical and digital infrastructure of the project or the proposed initiative. How it may ultimately, you know, project only the China's image or China's naval power. One another impact is that non-participation may lead to the reality of US strategy of containment of Asia rather than India's vision of cooperation for helping each other, China and India. And other impacts you can add from the analysis. With this, we come to the end of today's analysis. And if you like the video, press the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy for more updates and content on civil service preparation.